Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Extra Magic Hour. We're brought to you by Walt's Apartment Podcast and Getaway Today. We'll be your host on this magical journey into the Disney parks. It's a perfect gig for us because we love to talk about Disney. Is everyone ready? We're ready when you are, CB.
The Extra Magic Hour.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Extra Magic Hour. We are a Disney Parks podcast brought to you by the DisInsider.com and Getaway Today. I'm so excited to be back with my two hosts here. We have Sam and Breanna. How are you guys doing tonight?
Hey, I'm happy to see you guys tonight.
Yeah, Breanna, how are you? Good. I'm great. Good.
Ethan might try to make it in. I know he's doing some stuff. He's in the process of packing and moving and going to Walt Disney World tomorrow. So he's got a good excuse. So we're going to have a fun show. We actually have a TikToker. Is that you call them TikTokers?
Yeah.
A TikToker.
A TikTok influencer.
Her name is Megan. She's the magical millennial on TikTok. She has 55,000 followers and like 3.5 million likes so far. So she's doing something right. So we're going to have her on. I'm going to interview her in a little bit. But so we're going to talk about some parks news. Sam's got an Imagineer feature. I have a question for everyone, and we're just going to have a good show like we normally do. But first, you're going to tell us what Force Friday is. Let's talk about that real quick.
Force Friday is our Star Wars podcast that, shows up when we need it to. Mm-hmm. When we've got some Star
Which
Wars content.
Which will be soon, I think.
Yeah, so, we've got a lot coming, at the end of this year, beginning of next year. So just be on the lookout for that.
Yes. Exciting, and then we always have the Marvel Tribe, which both of you are part of the Marvel Tribe. Which
we love it.
There's just always so much stuff on the Marvel Tribe. So, Sam, what is the Marvel Tribe? Tell us when that comes out.
The Marvel Tribe is our bi-weekly show. It comes out Sunday nights, Monday mornings. It is where we discuss all things Marvel. It can be from the comic books. It can be from Disney Plus shows, feature films. All things Marvel for every level of fandom, and we are amazing and awesome, so you should check us out because
if you say so yourself, right?
I am a Leo, so I'm allowed to say so myself.
Okay.
But Shawn, you know we're the best.
I know. I made that show. I know.
So then don't.
No, absolutely. You guys are great, and I'm bummed I'm not on there all the time, so maybe I'll come back every now and then. Check out our show. And obviously, we have our Walt's Apartment live stream every Wednesday night on Facebook, which is our main podcast that we put out on Thursday mornings. So if you don't catch it on live stream, you can catch it on Thursday mornings on the podcast version of it. So let's get into some stuff. We're going to talk about some parks news. We're going to talk about what's the first story here. There's some interesting stories this week from all over the world, which is nice. So the first one here is Shanghai reopens November 3rd. After a full closure due to the COVID. It says that Shanghai Disneyland has tested 30,000 park guests for one positive test. It says they have tests of an upward of 34 in a single night in the past. So I guess they really test really well in Shanghai to make sure that they're safe. And they actually test the guests, it sounds like, which I think is kind of crazy. But, I mean, what do you guys think about that?
That sounds like a lot.
It's a lot of tests.
It's a lot of tests to find one. I mean, that's
right.
I think I read that article all wrong, but it sounds like they only found one positive out of 34,000. Yeah. Is what it seems like, which that's pretty damn good.
Yeah.
That one person, but you know,
it did not have spread it to others. We'll take it.
Yeah, for sure.
But I feel like that is a bit extreme to test that many people because of like one exposure.
Well, I think Shanghai that was the first park that closed? So
probably.
It was Shanghai or Hong Kong or one of the first two that actually closed for COVID. So they're fully back open now, finally, which is nice. And from what I read that they're open completely to everything. So, I mean, shows are back, characters are back. So, but they're doing something right with the test. So good for them. Any thoughts on Shanghai? Anyone? Anyone?
I want to go.
I definitely want to go. I know Paris is doing a lot of, you need a lot of vaccination proof or and negative tester proof or I'm not sure, but I was like, so I don't know if that's what they're doing or they're just individually testing you but hey.
So this isn't in the news, but a question for you guys, just, Sam, you're dealing with some stuff, with your school right now with tests and vaccinations and stuff like that. But you know, like LA County right now in California, they're requiring that you have to have vaccinated or proof of a test. Are you surprised that the Disney parks in the United States haven't gone that way yet? Have to ask for a vaccine card or?
Not really.
No, because I don't know. The American market is a huge market for mm-hmm. the Disney company. Mm-hmm. And I feel like the American public seems to be more resistant to these things. Yep. And mm-hmm. if they were to mandate it, they would lose a large chunk of their money. Yep. And I think they're afraid of that.
Yeah, I don't think Walt Disney World even can, right? It's Governor of Florida made that like impossible to mandate vaccines.
I don't know though, because technically Walt Disney World isn't under Florida government rule.
Well, they're under the county, which would be under the state rule, right?
But no, aren't they their own entity?
I'm not sure.
They have that's why they have the Reedy Creek Fire Department.
Oh.
Because like they have their own public service systems. So I don't think that they have to follow state or local rules.
Well, I feel like that would still be under a state, though. Like, even if it's considered a town or a county by themselves.
Right.
Like, cities with their own fire departments still have to follow state rules.
Yeah. I don't know.
I don't fully know, but if I had to think about it that way, that's how I don't know, though.
I think they are their own entity. I had no idea they were their own entity.
They're basically their like Celebration is Disney. Well, I don't know that it still is, but it was initially like Disney property.
Right. Huh. I had no idea. Next story we can move on to here.
They did that when they were opening the parks in Florida because they didn't want to be subject to jurisdiction of local law, basically.
Right.
So that was what their reason for making sure that they had like the public services and all of that, because then they kind of got to set their own rules.
That makes sense. And they're the size of what San Francisco, correct? That's how big Walt Disney World proper is mm-hmm. that's how big it is, correct? Or is mm-hmm. it Manhattan? It's one of the two, I think, that's how big it is. So
it is big.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Big.
That's crazy. You think Disneyland itself, when it opened, was 55 mm-hmm. acres. You know, just that's nothing. That's the owner of my car dealership has a pond on his property. That's 50 acres. So it's just like, you know, that it's like, dang, that's the size of Disneyland in your backyard, but whatever. Next story real quick. Hong Kong, a new nighttime spectacular. Cherish the Memories will premiere on Hong Kong Disneyland's Castle of Magic Dreams in 2021. Lucky guess. The show will include projections, mapping, lasers, searchlights, pyrotechnics, and fountains. The Castle of Magic Dreams will turn into a canvas of light and sound, taking you on a journey of life's cherished moments. Kind of sounds like what they do here for, what's it called? Enchanted. And they do the same thing for at Disneyland as well. So yeah, I'm glad we get some other news and other things are happening all over the world when it comes to the park. So I think that's pretty cool. So
I'm glad that we're getting new news, like a new shows, and not just like we're finally bringing something back that we didn't have for a year because of COVID. So it's happy to like see new things and us moving on and getting back and
new hope moving forward.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And honestly, I did see the concept art for this show and it looks beautiful.
Yeah. It sounds cool. I'm looking forward to it. So looking forward to seeing it. Go ahead.
It looks insanely, I don't know if overwhelming. I mean, I'm sure if I was there, it'd be like, you know, like the emotional overwhelm, but like, when I'm thinking about it, I was like, California has, like in DCA, they would have the water projection shows. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, you went over to Disneyland and then you had the castle projection shows and kind of the same like in Walt Disney World where you had the water projection shows at Animal Kingdom and then a castle projection show at Magic Kingdom. And they're throwing all that together and there's a water projection and a castle going on. And I'm like, whoa.
Yeah. Right. No, Hong Kong, I mean, the Asian market does really well and they go over the top with everything. Look at Shanghai's pirates. I mean, that's Shanghai, right? The one that's with the backwards boats and everything. Mm-hmm. They take it to a whole new level there, which is cool.
Ugh, so. And Tokyo Sea.
Yeah.
It's like my dream park to visit.
Tokyo Sea looks cool. That's the one that they,
it's got all of the Adventures Club stuff.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
it looks Porto cool. Paradiso and all that.
So Breanna brings up the idea of bringing back something that has been around forever. And you two did the live stream last week. So thank you so much for doing that. And I appreciate that. I didn't see the whole thing. I don't know if you guys brought this up, but the Main Street Electrical Parade is coming back again for like the 400th time. How excited are you guys for that?
I think we both actually talked about how we've never seen it in person. What? So,
yeah. Well, Are you serious? Oh,
it's just one of those things. Like, it disappears. And like, I really didn't start going to the parks consistently until 2018. So
okay, that's fair. Have you seen Paint the Night? Have you guys both seen Paint the Night?
I have seen Paint the Night. It's never been at Walt Disney World.
Okay. My perfect scenario, I mean, Electrical Parade is going to be 50 years old next year. That's why they're bringing it back again. Or speculation, because they really haven't said that it's coming soon. But we know what that means. That means it's sitting in the warehouse in Anaheim. It's coming back again. Perfect scenario would be to mix both shows, to mix Paint the Night and Electrical Parade somehow. I think would be the coolest thing ever. I don't know how they could do it because Electrical Parade is so old and janky looking, but cool. But Paint the Night is just so...
The Paint the Night floats are insane. Like,
I mean, I've seen videos of both and they both look incredible, but Paint the Night definitely looks more up my alley. I did just look this up while we were talking and I wish Shawn Nyberg was here to explain the legal to us, but it does look like they are not subject to Florida law, but just US law.
Okay.
Really?
I could be reading this entirely wrong. That's why I wish Shawn was here. So Shawn Nyberg, if you're listening, please tell me.
Yeah, let us know, Shawn, if you know for sure. And then obviously it's November 4th when this November 5th when this episode's coming out. I'm sorry. And it's Christmas is now back at the parks.
Yeah.
You have, I'm going to get down here on my notes. Christmas merch has hit all the parks. One of the big themes this year is Walt's Holiday Lodge, which sounds kind of cool, which inspires Mickey and his pals celebrating the holidays at the Ski Castle Lodge, which sounds kind of cool. I want to thank my friend for getting all this news because I had no idea that this stuff was happening. So, but I appreciate it. For you in California, I think in Florida, the tree is already up, right? They can like just snap their fingers and the tree's up the next day.
It was like the next morning. It was November 1st morning and I saw all the pictures of the tree.
And I will say TikTok is cool because you see all these TikToks. Have you all seen a TikTok with the pumpkins and then you have Mariah Carey carrying the baseball bat and beats the crap out of the pumpkins. And now it's Christmas time. Love it. The DCA tree lighting is November 12th. And that's when they actually kick off Christmas at Disneyland as well. So when it takes Disneyland a little bit longer than Florida to get ready. So I know right now it's still partially pumpkins, partially trees. They had snow on the castle last week before Halloween. Mm-hmm. So because that takes a while to do that. So Disneyland's a little behind. They don't have as much staff, I guess, as they do in Florida to decorate or whatnot. But candlelight ceremony will be back at it looks like it's going to be at Disneyland. It'll be on December 4th and 5th. And have either one of you seen the one of the candlelight processions or seen what they are?
No.
Have you seen, but you know what they are, right?
Yes.
So they're having that. It looks like on the 4th and 5th at Disneyland. And I don't see on here when it says, do they do that at Walt Disney World as well?
Some Epcot, years.
Right.
Yes.
Epcot? Okay. Yeah. So it's always a kind of a big deal. Who's going to be the ones doing their reading? I know it's been Neil Patrick Harris. It's been, Lin-Manuel Miranda has done it in the past. Chris Pratt has done it. So from what I've seen at Disneyland, so
Zaddy.
Okay. Perfect. So we will move on to our last story. And Walt Disney World, when magic key holders get in the gates, they will now get a new spark of purple that will light up rather than a typical green and a special new sound. Supposedly, this new purple sound, this new purple light, and this new sound has to do with Figment. So,
I was hoping so.
Right, that's what I've heard. That's what I read. So,
what if it says like one little spark?
That'd be cool.
This is at Disneyland.
Walt Disney World. It's where it's when it says when you for when the it says magic key holders. So that was
That's why I was sorry. Yeah. It's a little
no, it is at Walt Disney World. So that's okay. Walt Disney World annual pass holders. We'll get a new spark of purple, which maybe it will be one little spark.
I was going to say, I don't know if you have to have like the special 50th pass holder card but it lights up blue when
Is that
it lights up like a no, I have the old one. It didn't come out until like the week after.
Oh, gotcha. Perfect. So that's kind of our news. Do you guys have any other news besides how excited you are for Electrical Parade to come back? I mean, it's going to be so cool.
Maybe I'll get to see it. I don't know, though, because every reservation is gone forever.
I will
for
tell
the rest
you,
of your life.
For the rest of...
I think we talked about this in our last show, but it's just so
it's
bad.
It's got worse since then.
It's gotten worse. If you're a dream key holder at Disneyland, I'm sorry. Because you got... I love Disney. Chris Provost from Provost Park Pass loves Disney and is not happy right now. I mean, he said you are screwed if you are a dream key holder. You supposedly have no blackout dates, but if you can buy a ticket, you can get a reservation whatever day you want.
Yeah.
So they made a bunch of money off the annual pass, which is really sad and unfortunate. And I hope they fix. I know they actually paused the sales of the. Of the dream key. Hopefully they're retooling it to figure something out. So yeah, thoughts on that?
I mean, I just know, I mean, Disneyland's always been known for having tons of annual pass holders and everyone went right back to buying the annual passes. I do remember being nervous about this when I bought mine, but I didn't think it was actually going to be this bad. Like I was like, no, like I come from out of state. Like I have to plan, like, so it'll be okay. But I was like, okay, man, I gotta like plan 6 months in advance.
It's
like,
sad because you spend that. What key do you have?
I have the lowest one that you can get for the not resident. Yeah.
Yeah, that's the one I have too. And it's just like I've heard, because I've known people that you can actually go on and actually like and every morning you can go on and try a check and you might go get lucky to get your day. You just don't know. It's like a lottery. And that's scary when you if you want to go to Disneyland in a few weeks. But these people that are going back and forth. I'm going to ask Megan about this in the interview, you know, because I don't know what pass she has, but I mean, she seems to get in whenever she wants. She's always there.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, it's unfortunate. I feel really sad for the people that spent that $1,400. I mean, basically all you're getting from the other one is you're getting free parking, which they've raised the price of that too, because it was $25, now it's $30.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's just, it's unfortunate. It's unfortunate time. And I hope they fix that really soon. So.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know if they're going to raise capacity. I don't know what it's at. I don't think anyone knows anymore. It looks crowded. But...
Oh, my God. I will tell you, when I was there 3 weeks ago, I've been there 100, 150 times, and I've never seen it that crowded. The lines were absolutely – we didn't talk about it on our last show. The lines were absolutely insane for everything. An hour for Pirates. At one time it was 240 minutes for the Haunted Mansion.
First, I thought you were going to say Pirates, and I'm like,
no,
for Haunted Mansion, especially holiday. I semi understand, but that's still insane.
But still, I learned that it's nowhere near that, because I went there like at 10 o'clock one night. I walked over there and it said it was 160 minutes. So I'm like, okay, so I'll wait. I don't care if I'm in line. They have to put me on. I was on in like 45 minutes.
I was going to say that's pretty much been my experience. I'm hoping that they're always just kind of raising those times to, lower your expectations. I did see, I don't fully know, but I saw it on quite a few sites that Web Slingers is going to stand by line tomorrow.
Yes.
I guess
the fourth
Thursday. Yeah.
The fourth. Yeah. That's another one too, that when we were there last time talking about Web Slinger, it's fun. Mm-hmm. But you get your virtual queue and you come back and you're in line for another hour.
The first time my friend and I rode, it was in almost 2 hours in line after our virtual queue.
After your virtual queue. So you're like, damn, this is, and it wasn't worth an hour and a half wait. I don't think it was fun, but
I have fun on that first wait. I would never do again. The second wait was about 45 minutes and that's fine.
Yeah.
Still rough after, after a couple rides, I still wouldn't even wait that, but.
Right. I'm sorry, Sam. We went on Disneyland talk.
Oh, that's okay. I was listening.
So that's it for the news. So we're going to move on to our next feature, our Imagineer feature. But I know Sam has a little bit something different for us in store this week. So please explain.
I will. So we've been just talking about the different Imagineers that there are, like the legendary Imagineers. But I have this book that I came across, which is called The Imagineering Workout. Exercises to Shape Your Creative Muscles. And it was written by all of the Imagineers, not all of them, but many of them, a lot that we've already talked about in our Imagineering features as well. And it's basically advice about how to get your creative muscles working and how to start thinking like an Imagineer. So I thought it might be fun to share those every once in a while. So
absolutely.
The first piece of advice I have is from Tom Fitzgerald, who we already did talk about. He's an executive vice president, senior creative executive. And this is about storytelling and storyboarding. It says, storytelling is probably the oldest form of communication. In fact, it's been around so long that John Hench, Disney legend and senior vice president of creative development, used to insist that it's in our genes. Storytelling has played a vital role in our survival. Survival. Oh my goodness. I can't even talk today. Allowing us to share information, knowledge, and values from generation to generation. Story is the medium through which we receive our early learning as to right and wrong, good versus evil, reward and punishment, social values, etc. As a kindergarten teacher, that is absolutely right. Like, storytelling is the key to everything for young children. Whether genetically based or learned, we respond to storytelling. It engages our attention, and no matter how old we get, who doesn't love a good story? Storytelling works. We know that Disney's great about storytelling, like Star Wars, Marvel, all of the entities of the company. Amazing. So the way that Imagineers do that in the Disney company is through storyboarding. So here's what Tom Fitzgerald says about storyboarding.
Okay, give it to us.
Walt Disney invented the storyboard in the days of his early cartoon films. Basically, storyboards are a series of images that illustrate the flow and continuity of a story. It's a tool that allowed Walt Disney and his artists to envision a film prior to production, and it allowed Walt's team to have a shared vision of the story they were telling and how it could unfold. In addition to driving the creative development, storyboards offered Walt a cost-effective way to experiment with the film prior to cameras rolling. Have you ever seen where, like, Imagineers will go in and they'll be like, Walt would walk in and like destroy my storyboard? Mm-hmm. And so, I mean, Walt was the master of the storyboard. He came up with the concept and he was the first Imagineer, honestly. So,
oh, yeah.
When Walt ventured into live action films, he continued to use storyboards to pre-visualize the story. At Walt Disney Imagineering, we carry on the tradition, often storyboarding rides, shows, and films for our theme parks around the world. Starting in brainstorming sessions with note cards, quick sketches, and plenty of push pins. We capture our first thoughts, ideas, images, and feelings about the story we are creating. We work and rework the boards until we feel that our story is strong and clear. Only then do we venture onto a soundstage or proceed with models in three-dimensional production. At Walt Disney Imagineering, everything revolves around the story, and storyboards are an essential tool in helping us tell the story. So often it all starts with images or words recorded on note cards pinned to a wall. The note cards are a recurring motif that you will find as you venture forth discovering your own creative ideas and your stories you want to tell. So basically, Tom Fitzgerald is saying, like, every good idea at the Disney company starts with a storyboard. And he, like, they've, in this book, they kind of encourage you to start doing storyboarding in your own life with, like, any idea that you have. Like, if you have a project you want to work on and you can't really get your mind around it, just start writing notes on note cards and put them up. And yep. Eventually, like, you can map out this grand plan that you have, even for your life, like your goals, goal setting, you could use storyboarding.
That's true.
So thanks, Tom Fitzgerald.
Yeah. I like that. And it's funny, you talk about Walt being the original Imagineer and all this stuff. What did Walt really not do or create? I mean, Walt created freaking a live animated cartoon. He got the idea of putting music to a cartoon. I mean, where would we honestly be? I mean, someone would have
been obviously. Live action, yeah. Nature documentaries.
Yeah, it's just, God dang, you know, you just think about it.
Voice acting.
Yeah.
Animated characters, pretty much everything.
One dude. I mean, honestly, you think about it, it's absolutely insane to actually think about
but that. Walt would never say it was just him.
Right.
He would always say, no, it's my team. He was very much into giving credit where it was due when it came to his Imagineers. He handpicked them because he believed in them and he wanted to challenge them. And they were very successful because they worked well with him.
Right. No, absolutely.
It's just absolutely great that, I mean, he would say yes to this. Like, even like, yeah, maybe he would give the credit to his team, but he was the one to come in and say yes and not be afraid to push the boundaries in something new. Because if we would have never pushed anything new, we'd still be watching silent movies. So
exactly. So thank you, Walt. Yeah. I guess that's the moral of that whole thing is thank you, Walt. And storyboards, I think it's a great idea, actually, like you said, to you could actually put a storyboard anything to make anything better, I think.
Yeah, I took a visual communications class and we had a storyboard for all of our projects. And I still remember they gave us special papers where you could draw on top and then write what you were doing at the bottom. And we would just like lay there in like the classroom on the tables being like, I don't know. And then throwing them up on a wall and then moving them around. Everything. Yeah,
but it came out fine, right?
Kind of. You know, when your budget's $5.
Well, yeah. But I mean, your concept was there.
Yes. Right. We'd be like, we don't need to do this. Our teacher, like, yes. You're like, no. And then we'd stand there for like 2 hours trying to figure it out.
Perfect.
Your teacher wasn't like Walt and came and said, no, redo it all.
Thank you, Sam. I appreciate that.
Of course.
I like that idea of going back and forth with something like that than the Imagineers. I think that's a cool mix up. So we'll continue to do that.
Yeah.
I almost forgot. I skipped over it. I skipped over Disney Parks. Did you know? Before we move on to our interview with Megan, hopefully you all did your homework. Who wants to go first with a Disney Parks Did You Know tidbit?
You said TikTok, and I was like, or you were talking about TikTok, and I was I didn't even know we had an assignment. Have you seen those videos where it's like, actually, I understood the assignment. Actually, I didn't even know there was an assignment.
Right. Actually, I was unaware there was an assignment.
Brianna, do you want to go first?
I can go first.
Okay.
So mine is about the hottest girl in school. More TikToks. The Epcot ball. So I actually never thought about this until I was trying to find something.
She's
real fancy now. She has got hotter for the 50th. My gosh. I'm sorry. Now I'm going to think about the lights. They're so pretty. Anyway. So I was trying to find something on Epcot because she's my favorite. And I never thought about this before, but the way that it's set up as a ball, like when it rains in Florida, it pours. Rain should be flowing down and around and under the ball, but they've actually got a special set of gutters on Spaceship Earth that take the water in and inside and then down into the lagoon. So no one gets wet if you stand under. Yep.
That is creative Imagineering. Like they literally think of everything sometimes.
Right. I was like, they're like, oh, sometimes people are going to get soaked under here. No, we got this. Like we've got this figured out.
And you know, they did it on a storyboard first.
I'm sure.
It's their first idea. It's a storyboard.
But I mean, to even like think through that is amazing. It goes to show like how much, maybe not as much anymore, but how much Imagineers think about the big picture and like every single detail on the way.
Yeah, that I was trying to like find to like see if they added it later after they realized what was happening, but I never found anything like that. So from what I'm gathering, they put this in first thing. Like they knew what was going to happen and they made sure to take care of it.
That's
I will text someone and get the answer to that for you, Brianna.
It's funny because you talk about Imagineerings and how they think of stuff, and mine actually kind of ties into that, but it doesn't directly, but it's kind of the same idea about practicing something and thinking it out. So did you want to go, Sam, or you want me to go with mine real quick?
I'll go.
Go ahead.
Unless you want to go first.
No, I'm going to go ahead.
Okay. I briefly mentioned this last time we were doing our Disney Did You Knows. And we were talking about, Shawn is holding up a book that's it, or one of the Who Was Walt Disney books. I briefly mentioned that the lands in Magic Kingdom all have grounds that correlate. So you can look down and figure out what land you're in. Mm-hmm. So when you're walking down Main Street, you're walking down the red carpet. It's red. You're walking down the red carpet towards the main attraction, mm-hmm. which is Cinderella Castle.
Right.
As you step over into Tomorrowland and you look down, it looks like there are like gears and cogs and stuff in the pavement, which is very like, you know, future world. Not future world, but futuristic.
And then Liberty Square, of course, there is that lovely brown pavement that runs down the middle, aka the poop road, because in colonial times, they would take their chamber buckets and toss them out the window because there was no plumbing. So there's
that was actually was going to be before I found my Epcot one was that there's no bathrooms in Liberty Square because there was no plumbing.
Yeah, there's no plumbing. I have lots of Liberty Square did you knows. We'll have to go through those because the details that they put into Liberty Square, perfect. And then when you go over to Adventureland, there's like shells and stuff because like Pirates is over there. So there's like shells and stuff in the pavement, the ground. So just you can look down and figure out what land you're in.
That's pretty cool. Mine is back at Disneyland. And when they were designing Disneyland, obviously Main Street is brick, right? There's bricks everywhere. The buildings are made out of brick. There's this one spot in Disneyland, Brianna, maybe help me out. It might be by the Starbucks. It might be down that walkway of the Starbucks. But there is a wall.
Of course,
down.
You would connect it to Starbucks.
That's right. That's right. Because Starbucks pink drink. Let's go. But down at the end of this wall, there's a wall, and on this wall there's a bunch of different bricks. There's bricks here. There's some like rough bricks, some smooth bricks, mm-hmm. and Walt did this on their ability to see what would look the best. When they built the park, they just left this wall there, and this wall that you could actually see it, and it's like all these different kinds of, you know what I'm talking about, Brianna? Have you seen that?
I have, and I honestly I'm trying to remember.
I think
it's kind of like Walt's storyboard.
There you go.
Storyboard kind of, it's the same idea. So I think it's cool. I think it is the walkway that's out of we exit Starbucks. It's right over there on the
that's
side.
Okay, yeah.
And you just have like all these different brick configurations, and I just think it's so cool they left that there 66 years later. And it looks kind of like crap, but I mean, I get the idea why they did it, and it's just cool that it was left. And that's my Disney parks. Did you know? Which lets us move on to our interview with Megan, the magical millennial from TikTok. Gonna sit down with her and talk to her and find out how she got started, a little bit about the business that she runs as well. So we hope you enjoy the interview, and we'll be right back. Hey everyone, welcome to Extra Magic Hour again. I'm Shawn, and I'm so excited to be joined by Megan. And I cannot say your last name, Megan. I don't know how to say it. How do you say your last name? Hennigan?
Hennigan.
Mm-hmm. Hennigan, okay. She is the magical millennial on TikTok. She has almost 55,000 followers on TikTok and 3.5 million likes so far. And your content is absolutely the best. It's so much fun, and you take a lot of the TikTok trends that are out there, and like you said on our live stream, you put them into Disney, which is great. Like the Slade one, I think is absolutely great. And
thank you.
Yeah, you're just amazing. So tell us a little bit about you. Tell us how you started TikTok and why you started TikTok. And don't worry about the background sound. That's fine. That's fine.
I apologize for that.
No, it's fine.
So I got started on TikTok, honestly, earlier this year. We took a trip because Disneyland was still closed. So me and my best friend took a trip to Disney World for her bachelorette. And I filmed a TikTok there again with a kind of trending sound that went viral, or, you know, mm-hmm. took off, as one would say. And I was like, oh, that's really exciting. It's really cool. You know, didn't think too much of it then, but I started to make more videos with more sounds that I was frequently finding on my For You page. Right. And relating them to something Disney. And then those started to do really well. And I was like, oh, okay. I think I could do this pretty well. So then the idea started flowing month after month. I would gain some traction with the following and with the likes and everything. And yeah, so from there on, it was just, you know, okay, let's have fun with this. Let's keep it going. Let's make it light and positive. That's what I really try to do with my content, is to make sure everyone's, you know, not thinking that I'm bashing on something that, you know, right. Disney does, but keeping it positive. So that's kind of how it all got started.
No, it's the way you do stuff. You did the one with Thor trying to sign in, and I didn't play it on our live stream, but he kept saying Thor, and they're like, deny. Then you did it as being Bob Chapek coming to D23, which I thought was brilliant. And so is that on TikTok? Is that what you do? You just kind of get an idea from like what's trending and say, hey, how do I flip this into Disney? And is that what you do, or is that your thought process?
That's exactly how it goes. Yes. Yeah. So I'll hear a sound, I'll watch a video. Usually it does not have to do with Disney. Mm-hmm. And I'll be like, oh, I could relate that to this, whether it's a current event or, you know, a ride or something. Mm-hmm. That's usually how my brain works. So that's how I was working with TikTok. And I had been doing, I hate to say it, but I had done so much scrolling and saving of sounds during COVID, because mm-hmm. that's when I downloaded the app. So
I think everyone did.
Yeah.
Then, so.
Right. Everyone got on TikTok then.
Yeah.
So, that's kind of what I do. I just scroll, hear a sound, and I'm like, okay, I do put it in my notes on my phone that this is what we're going to, this is what the concept is going to be.
Right. Yeah. So if you guys, this is an audio podcast, so you can't see Megan right now. She is actually took her time away from Disneyland to be sitting in the Disneyland hotel to take the time to be on with us. So I greatly appreciate that so much. And
of course,
talking about Disney, tell me how you got your love for Disney. Where did that start?
That started when I was very, very young. Actually, I used to live in Northern California. So lived up there. So lived farther away from the parks. My mom was really into Disney kind of growing up. She loved it. She loved taking the kids. And so we started doing these family trips with me and my like cousins and everything down to Disneyland. Mm-hmm. We'd stay over at the Hilton Suites, which is what is now the Embassy Suites off the 5 freeway. And we would just take these. And they literally were the best memories I had as a kid. Doing that 7-hour drive from the Bay Area and coming down to Anaheim. And then we finally moved to Southern California when I was about 9 years old. And that was actually around the time they released the first annual passes for Disneyland. So picked those up immediately. My mom was like, yep, we're just going to go all the time. And, you know, it'll be us. It was me and my brother at the time. And I do have a sister who's 15. So we have a 13-year age gap. And so when I was young and she started coming, I was just like, you know, it was so much fun to have a little sister to take around. Yeah. And so it just continued through my teenage years. I took a little break in college because I went up north again. But, then after that, I met actually my best friend, Jackie, who we're going to talk about in a second with our business. And we are just, you know, the best of Disney friends going all that's the time. So cool. And, so that's kind of that's the whole story.
That's so cool. So yeah, I'm originally from Southern California. I live in Southern Oregon now, but we come down every year or twice a year for trips. I'm from Ventura County, from Simi Valley originally. So, I mean,
yes.
We would go me and my wife, we would go every Friday. We would leave and go right to the parks and, you know, and every, all the time. And that's so same thing for me. It just became a constant in your life. And that's just what it is. My kids, my grandkids are all huge Disney fans down and love it. So you did talk about your friend, Jackie. You do have a business, and that's kind of what I want to talk to you about, because I think it's a really cool idea what you guys do. So tell me about the business, how it got started and what you guys do.
Yes. So we are the My Oh My Planners. That is our name. That's our website, myomyplanners.com. We got started. I'll tell you what it is first. We are a park planning business who also specializes in magic mail. So we create, think of it as like a FabFitFun box, where we have different tiers of boxes to put personalized custom Disney items in. And we could make from canvas bags to t-shirts to water bottles to ears themselves. We put it all into these boxes and mail it out to you for honestly and anything. It could be a special occasion, could be a birthday coming up, or just that you miss Disney and you don't live near the parks. We have tiers of that. So we got the basic box, which has, you know, a cute custom things in it, and some artwork as well. Jackie is an amazing artist. Should be an artist here, honestly. And then the deluxe comes with, you know, a water bottle. It's got the ears, and our ultimate box is the one that has the park ears that you would see here, or on shopdisney.com. So, we have that. And then we also specialize in park itineraries. So we'll make itineraries for people who are going to Disney World or Disneyland and basically get it down to like the time of day you want to be doing things with your family or your significant other, if it's a special occasion. So we like to consider ourselves the park experts, and we'll break it down for you and what would give you the perfect Disney day.
That's so cool.
So that's kind of both of our combined areas of expertise that we thought of it because, first of all, we miss Disneyland like crazy. Mm-hmm. And we miss Disney in general. So we're like, why isn't there something that you could purchase or you could have delivered to you that would give you that Disney magic feeling again. And then the itineraries were kind of my brainchild. I had been thinking of that for years. So we kind of put those together to create My Oh My. And actually the My Oh My, it's also a fun little backstory behind that. We're spending weeks coming up with our name. And the My Oh My came up because the line after that from Zippity Doodah is What a Wonderful Day.
Right.
So we kind of like that concept. And then we thought of the O and the H in My Oh My, and the O is for Jackie Owens. My last name is Hennigan. So okay. The OH. And we were just like, yep. Okay. That's the one.
I love it. That's so cool. So I will put, if you're fine, I'll put a link to your site on our show notes for this. So people can click on it and check it out if you're okay with
Absolutely.
That. So
absolutely. Thank you.
So I have to ask, because you, part of your business is planning. So what is your opinion of the genie?
I think the genie is great. I think it's a great idea. It's a great, helpful tool to use at the parks. I'm astounded that they haven't thought of this sooner, honestly, right. Especially with the crowds becoming more frequent. And so I'm looking forward to it. I'm looking forward to see how it works. I've heard good things actually over at Walt Disney World. So I'm interested to see how it works at Disneyland.
You don't need it because you can plan your own stuff. You're like me. We can just plan our own stuff.
I will say that I don't think I need an app to tell me where to go after I do Haunted Mansion or something. But you know, it'll be fun to see, like, okay, here's the wait time for this ride. You should, you might think about going over this way. We'll see how it works over here. I have not seen it myself. But I'm definitely interested. Sure.
I've seen some videos on it. It looks pretty cool. It looks like a really good idea.
It does.
Talking about that, since you go to Disneyland so much.
Yes. And,
what are your thoughts on the Lightning Lane? Would you pay for that?
I would absolutely pay the $20 on a big Disney day with my family or a friend who's coming from out of town. 100% would pay for it to get on the rides faster. On a day like this, where I'm here for maybe a couple hours, absolutely not, which is quite frequently. It's easier for us to say yes to it simply because we had the Max Pass, which was very, very similar to this.
Right.
In before they closed in 2020. So Walt Disney World, it's a very different system. So I can see how they'd be a little adverse to it over there. But over here, you know, it's the only qualm I have is that as of right now, it's not a prepaid option. You can't add it to a magic key. Maybe in the future they'll add that. But it's, $20 to get on Space Mountain in 5 minutes instead of an hour. Absolutely.
100%. I totally agree with you. Would you pay $15 just to ride Rise of the Resistance?
No, that I would not.
No?
Do.
No?
unless a friend was coming from out of town, has never been on it, then I would do it. And then they would owe me a beer at California Adventure. But
well, I get that because we were just on our live show. And we talked about, what's got to go, Rise of Resistance or Pirates. And I 100% agree with you that Rise would have to go because it's just I'm a huge Disney nostalgia, blah, blah, blah. Pirates was the last ride Walt worked on before he passed away. And my first experience on Rise of Resistance was not the best. We got the backup boarding groups. We had to run across the park to get there and then waited for 2 hours before we actually had to go. So I didn't like it at first. But then I went on it again this last time and I liked it. It was cool, but still no Pirates. I'm sorry. It's really cool and I love it. It's a great thing, but
It was fascinating to go on it at first because there was so much hype around it and Star Wars was still fresh off their movies that had just come out. And it wasn't like anything Disneyland has ever made, or any park has ever made, honestly. So it was very exciting to go on first. And then, once you've seen it, 10 times, it's just like, okay, so not much has changed. It's honestly, it's still amazing. It breaks down quite often, I will say.
I've heard that a lot.
More than any other ride, which is understandable. It's a 15-minute experience. It's something that I would love to take a friend on for the first time and see their reaction. But personally for me, I don't have to do it every time. Whereas Pirates, that's one of my favorite nighttime, I need to get off my feet kind of rides.
Yeah.
So I'd have to keep that around.
So a couple of questions for you before we ask you a couple. I just have like a few more. What's your favorite? What is your favorite ride?
My favorite ride at Disneyland, I feel very basic for saying this, it is Space Mountain.
Okay. Any particular reason why? Just...
I honestly, it's my giddy, happy feeling. Being in the front row on Space Mountain is like, just gives me all the joy.
Okay, that's totally like, fair.
Head to toe, so.
Favorite snack?
Favorite snack? First one that came to mind. Favorite savory snack is the jalapeno cheese pretzel from Refreshment Corner or from any pretzel stand. And then sweet snack is actually they don't have this right now, but it's the Fluffer Nut or Churro at California Adventure. It's a churro smothered in peanut butter, marshmallow sauce, and chocolate chips. And it is phenomenal.
That sounds absolutely amazing. It's amazing. I have a couple of questions here for you. I think I know the answer because I've seen a lot of your videos. And someone asked me to ask you this question. Have you ever justified purchasing something Disney just to make a TikTok about it?
I did, yes. Oh, 100%. And I will tell you which one it was. Have you seen the rats that crawl around on you from Disney World?
Yep.
They now sell those at California Adventure, by the way. But I spent twice as much to get that damn thing so I can make a TikTok of it. Excuse me for cursing. But I did spend money on it to make a TikTok of it. It did get over a million views, but I was like, Megan, seriously, like you did that? Like, oh my gosh. So yeah,
that video is hilarious too.
Thank you. Yeah. I appreciate absolutely. It. Thank you. But that's the backstory behind that video.
No, that's totally. We kind of talked about where you get your inspiration already. It's kind of like, it just kind of comes to you. And another question, is there a TikTok you've done that is your favorite more than any of the others? If so, why?
Oh, wow. Great question. I was really proud, and I did get a lot of backlash for this. It was kind of a controversial one, but I did make a childless millennial at Disneyland video that did pretty well. Has over a million views. Also has a lot of views on Reels on Instagram. Mm-hmm. And because I made it to a sound that I had created from Parks and Recreation, which is one of my favorite shows. Oh my gosh, what's her name? Catherine Hahn's character from that show who brags about not having kids. Mm-hmm. I plan on having kids, just for the record. But I made that video just to, kind of make fun of, being a childless millennial at Disneyland, not having kids to, take care of. I mean, it was totally for fun. It was a total parody. But I worked pretty hard on that one. So I will say it's one that I am, I guess, kind of proud of because I had created the sound and I liked how it turned out. So that's cool. The first one that comes to mind. Are there any other ones? I guess that's it for now.
Okay. No, that's awesome. Yeah. And I appreciate that. So you do, sometimes I see you do a few like collaborations with different other TikTok channels and stuff like that. Is there someone that you really like to collaborate with?
I do love Kelly Kobe. She is actually one of my like best Disney friends and just best friends in general. She actually has, I think, almost 45,000 followers on TikTok as well.
Is she the Disney Disorder one? The adult Disney Disorder? Or am I thinking something
else?
That's
our little group. Oh my gosh, that's our group. She's not on our group account officially. I think it is just Kelly Kobe is her handle.
Okay.
But adult is disorder. That's actually a really fun group that we have. That's me and Jackie, my best friend. And then Magically McMurray, who's from Utah, who goes to Disneyland she hasn't been to Disney World yet. And then Travel Agent William, who's actually very popular too. He's Disney World specifically. But we do collabs too on that account. And it's really fun. That one's definitely more adult Disney content.
I love it. We are. If you start watching our show, listening to it, we cuss on our show. We have some different. Yeah, it's we're not your normal podcast. We cuss every now and then and get called. We drop F bombs. I have to edit them out, and it's a bad thing. But I don't want to keep you any longer because I mean you've been with us for an hour for the show already, and taking the time to do this with me. And I can't thank you enough for joining us, and. Sharing some magic with us because I'm a huge fan of your stuff. My hosts are huge fans of your work. I have people tell me, oh my God, you're going to have her on. That's so cool. And are so excited about it. So, but I can't thank you enough, Megan, for taking the time to join us and tell us again, where we find your business and where we can find you on the social medias.
Absolutely. So my personal handle is themagicalmillennial_. That's both on Instagram and TikTok. And we also have our business, myomyplanners.com. Also myomyplanners on Instagram and TikTok.
Perfect. Again, Megan, thank you so much. And give me one second when we're done here. We're going to go back. We're going to take you back to Extra Magic Hour now. Thank you guys so much. Okay, cool. I want to thank Megan for joining us and being part of the Extra Magic Hour. She was also on the live stream this week as well. So we enjoyed spending time with her. But thank you, Megan. And check her out on TikTok at the Magical Millennial. So I was saying the Magic Millennial. It's the Magical Millennial. But make sure you check that out. Sam, tell us about Getaway Today.
Well, you see, if you want to travel to the most magical place on Earth, you could use our sponsor, Getaway Today.
Yep.
They will help you with all of your vacation planning needs. They are free to use. So I know there's the stigma that travel agents are going to just cost you more money. Not the case. Getaway Today is going to look for deals for you. They are going to help you get the most bang for your buck. And they can help you with vacation destinations all over the country. And they are awesome. Yep. So, Breanna, do you think they should get them some?
You should definitely get you some.
Okay, perfect. Yeah. Get you some. And Getaway Today, they're awesome. They are very cool. And they're just easy to deal with and easy to work with. David did his trip in July. I emailed him and said, hey, David, one of my hosts, and they did everything for him and they set him up and it was nice. So check out Getaway Today and get you some.
Yeah, so that's 1-800-GETAWAY or getawaytoday.com and tell them Walt's Apartment sent you or that's Extra right. Magic Hour.
Absolutely. So I want to move on. We're going to finish up real quick. I just have a question for you guys.
No.
Okay, perfect. Brianna, how about you?
Sure.
Okay, perfect. So thank you for listening this week. No, I'm just kidding. real quick, have you guys ever been on an attraction where it broke down? Someone sent me a message the other day, and it was a picture of someone on Pirates of the Caribbean in waders. You know, they were moving the boat because the people got stuck, and they're like, does this really happen? And I'm like, I've seen videos of that happening, but it's never happened to me on Pirates, which I think would be cool if that actually would happen. But you guys ever had anything happen to you like that?
I've had like a delay on Carousel of Progress where it was like the same scene. Mm-hmm. I've seen things where like people have to like use ladders to get people out of Peter Pan's flight. There was that huge thing last year I don't know if it was last year or the year before where they had to get people off of Big Thunder Mountain. Mm-hmm. So it happens.
And they had to evacuate people off the Skyliner.
Oh, no, thank you.
Oh, yeah, water evacuations on ladders.
I'd be like, y'all can just keep me here. I'm not getting out and stepping my fat ass out of a little bucket onto a ladder that high in the air. Not going to happen. No.
But what if it was a really handsome firefighter and he let you hold him on the way down?
Especially no. I mean, no. But I will say that I've been on our last trip. No, I won't even talk about that because that one's kind of just weird. We actually went on the ride and they did a switch over and they just sent us through again. We went through and okay, you're going again. And they didn't ask us. They just sent us again on the ride. I'm like, so that was weird. But we did actually a couple years ago, we were on Indiana Jones and the part there when he's hanging above you and he's hanging right above you, we actually stopped. And if you know how that part works, he's sitting there and everything starts shaking and then the walls actually come around you. They actually go past you. So we were stuck in that spot for 25 minutes with Indiana Jones like hanging right over us, which I thought was really weird. And so then it worked for a second. We went like 4 feet, then it stopped again. We went like another 5 feet. Then we finally got back around and they said, you guys want to go again? Because you had to wait. We're like, sure, why not? So they sent us again. And if you've been on Indiana Jones, the part when you're going through the fire where everything's going off and explosions on the bridge. Yeah, we stopped right there for another 10 minutes. So just Indiana Jones, I think, is the most notorious ride for breaking down. So,
yes.
But yeah, I just want to ask you guys if you guys had anything. Breanna, have you had anything?
So on Space Mountain at Disneyland, not fully sure what fully happened because I think every other car was able to go. But they loaded us into our ride vehicle and they started moving us forward, like you're getting ready to go on the ride. Then all of a sudden we took like a turn, and then they had to roll over this like step ladder for us to just get out. And then they just put us right back on another vehicle. I have no idea what happened. Like everyone's like, they weren't messing with like the seatbelts or like the lap bars. Like sometimes you'll hear them click often and they're like making you re-pull them down, but that wasn't happening. So they never told us what happened. They just moved us forward and then told us to get off.
Right.
And then the last time I was at Disneyland, we didn't have to evacuate, but we were on Pirates of the Caribbean for like double the amount of time you should have been, because the boats, we started hitting the boat in front of us, like in the beginning of like the Tortuga scene.
Oh, wow.
And I mean, we sat there forever. So, I mean, I don't even know how far it was backed up. I don't even know how they kept getting boats going through to like even get people going through, like, because it just had to be so backed up.
Speaking of boats, that reminded me of the Jungle Cruise. Imagine getting, you know, when that boat sunk.
Or the Splash Mountain log. I forget if it was the one at Disneyland or Walt Disney World.
Yeah, that was Walt Disney World, both.
I have this fear of dinosaur, of like getting stuck on the part where, you know, the jump scare is. I have this fear, like, what if I'm there and like, what if it, like, is it on a timer so it's gonna like stay there, or is it gonna go away and keep jumping at me?
Yeah, no thank you. Yeah, that's kind of what we got. If anyone listening, shoot us a message if you've ever gotten stuck on a ride, and we'll throw it on some of our social medias. That's going to bring us to the end of our Extra Magic Hour for this week. I want to thank Megan again. Check her out on TikTok at The Magical Millennial. And Breanna, Sam, thank you guys so much for joining me this week. Mm-hmm. And hope you guys have a magical day. Good night, everyone.
Bye.